When you're standing up on a stage in front of thousands of people, do you ever have those moments where you just take a step out of your body and look at yourself going, how the shit did I get here? Like, do you ever have those moments?
Definitely, yeah. I think that like the scariest thing to me is not just the people who are present, but like a live stream, you know, people watching on the internet. Like, I can't imagine the absolute vastness of 100 people's lives and all the thoughts and experiences and memories and feelings that 100 people have. It's way too huge to conceive of. And to think that like a million people are watching you at the same time, it's like trying to understand that or consider that. It's just like, to me, you just can't perform while thinking about that. So I try to zone out a little bit and just do what I'm there to do. But I definitely have these kind of lucid moments too, where it just occurs to me like how many eyeballs are on me at once, and it can be a little unsettling, but it's also totally an honor, yeah. I got interested in music when my older brother, when I was 12 years old, living in rural North Carolina on the East Coast of the United States, my older brother brought home a copy of the game Dance Dance Revolution, Japanese rhythm game. It's the first time I ever heard electronic music, and I just fell in love with it immediately. As soon as I knew that it was possible to make music with a computer, I tried to do it. At first, that was arranging loops poorly, and obviously, I think developed into something a little bit more sophisticated than that.
Just a little bit more sophisticated. Yeah. You have the curious distinction of being a musician that sung a duet with, I'm going to call it a robot, for lack of a better term.
Yeah.
Tell me about how your duet came about.
Well. There's a pretty famous software in Japan called Vocaloid, but it's basically, if you're familiar with Siri or any other kind of like text-to-speech program where you can write text and it'll say it back to you, it's the same idea just with melody added. So for each syllable, you choose a musical note, and the effect is a robot voice that sings. It works best, I think, in Japanese because Japanese is so, so syllabic. Their alphabet is composed of syllables rather than letters. So what I decided to do was take the English language version of that program and, yeah, sing a duet with a robot, essentially.
That track is also one of the, is it one of the first tracks that you've sung on as well?
Yeah.
Tell me about the process of singing for the first time on one of your tracks.
So I did have a couple of years before I sang for the first time, and I usually do before I perform live as well. You know, I definitely don't consider myself this like chops singer, this like, I wouldn't audition for The Voice or anything like that. Yeah, I think there's so many things in this world where like, where confidence is so much more important than having a high level of ability. A friend of mine uses this analogy all the time. He was talking about how if you were driving on a normal, like, one-lane road on the ground, you would almost never go over the line, just driving automatically. But if that same road, that same width, was sent like 100,000 feet up in the air, and you knew that if you went over the line you would die, I think your level of your ability would degenerate very fast, and you would just get scared and mess up and fall off and die, you know? So, like, he talks about the like 2 to 3 beer zone being a human's peak level of ability, which I don't think is true in all cases, like taking standardized testing, probably not true.
This is the most stressful thing I think I've ever experienced.
Is it true that you're just like a particularly massive fan of cheesy 2000s pop rock?
Oh yeah, yes, totally.
So like, who are we talking about here?
Vanessa Carlton. Michelle Branch, early Avril Lavigne for sure.
Early Avril Lavigne is definitely the good stuff.
What was it called? Let Go? That album was...
If we were going through your music, where would you find the inspiration there?
A Thousand Miles was one of the first songs I actually really truly loved. Like, I think that you can still hear echoes of that songwriting in the way I write music today. Like, music that's written for DJs has to serve a function. It has to be danceable. A lot of DJ music has these kind of non-musical but very functional and effective, like, build-up sections, you know, like 20 seconds of do 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 do. And all that exists for is to kind of increase the tension before a drop and let people know that an exciting moment is coming. And to me, I think there's no emotion in that, and I don't think it serves this great songwriting purpose. It's just, it's functional. And for the music I was trying to write it, when I was writing Worlds, it was coming at a cost. The thing I was most passionate about was I trying to write music that I guess was a little bit more touching.
How important is video game, the video game culture in sort of underpinning Worlds as an album?
I think that, like, so much of what I do is wrapped up in nostalgia, and video games are a big part of that. There's a game that I grew up with called Star Wars Galaxies. It's an online game where you have a persistent character and you exist in a virtual world. That game was so important to me. It's this open-ended, beautiful, vast digital landscape. I feel like I could take somebody on a tour through the best places there. You know, I really feel like I know the planets, and the game was effectively ruined and then shut down by the developers. And once the developers stop working on it, and once the servers have been shut down, the game is gone forever. And it's this very unique feeling that I got from it of just like your hometown being nuked. You know, obviously that's a huge exaggeration, but it's this feeling of, like, longing for a place that doesn't really exist. And that's why I think the big motif of my album was fiction and escapism and immersion into something that's not real.